Good morning, all. Good morning. And good morning, everyone out there virtually as well. I just wanted to welcome you to the House of Labor. Here we are. We wanted to bring everyone together today to have a frank and honest conversation about the economy and the way inflation affects working people's lives. And no discussion on inflation today would be complete without mentioning the news of this morning that everyone's paying attention to. After, I think, over 20 hours of negotiations, the rail unions and rail companies have reached a tentative agreement. Averting a strike that could have had a massive impact on our supply chain and our economy writ large. And we're still unpacking, no pun intended, all of the details around this deal. But all I can say is that, you know, the issue of sick leave and quality of life was front and center during this negotiation. And I think it very much raised awareness of what working people are grappling with, not just in the rail industry, but in industries across this country. And no one should have to fight for paid sick days or even unpaid sick days, which is what we were talking about with this negotiation. But we're anxious to continue to get more details. But as the president of the AFL-CIO, I get the incredible privilege of working with 12.5 million working people, 58 unions in the AFL-CIO who play a critical role in our economy. Everyone from those railway workers to nurses in emergency rooms who helped our loved ones battle COVID, the meat packers who make sure the food is on the shelves in our grocery stores, you know, the tradespeople who are at this very minute rebuilding our nation's crumbling infrastructure. And as of last week, your favorite baseball players who just joined the Federation. So we have voices all across this economy, and our members can be found in every corner of the country in every industry. But like all working families, they have been feeling the pinch of inflation. So before the Federal Reserve meets and potentially raises interest rates again, we want to gather experts, folks, you know, who are experts on the economy, have a conversation and really talk about some of the factors at play that are getting less attention in the media and the press. The truth is, there has been some good news and some progress on inflation. From today's rail news to falling gas prices to the passage of the Inflation Reduction Act. But there's also been some bad faith narratives circulating about around inflation. Like the idea that working people who've kept our country running during some of the most challenging years we've experienced are somehow to blame, or that it's the result of the critical investments the government has made in rebuilding our infrastructure. Nothing could be further from the truth. And if that narrative gets perpetuated, there's a real danger that it will influence the federal government's response and hurt hardworking families who are still working to build back from the pandemic. We've seen some economists suggest that the solution would be to have, I don't know, a year of 10% unemployment. Let's talk about that in real terms. That's 10 million people losing their jobs. That's 10 million families now struggling to put food on the table or make rent. That is not a solution. We've also seen some experts act as if this is a uniquely American problem and ignore the global trends that are clearly playing a role. From the way COVID and Russia's unjust war on Ukraine have disrupted supply chains, to the impacts of climate change on things like food production. Raising interest rates to fight market forces is a dangerous tactic that doesn't reflect the circumstances we're in. Higher interest rates will lead business to stop investing in their employees, hiring less, paying less, and laying people off, making it harder for working families to make ends meet. We have to take a holistic, realistic look at this problem. And that's the only way we can develop real solutions that offer real help and relief to working families. And we cannot pursue that relief if we are blaming households for spending too much money, and which is what the narrative is that we're hearing out there. We need Congress to continue focusing on working America's needs. A stronger care economy, affordable housing, and the ability to organize unions. And we need to keep investing in manufacturing so that we can strengthen our own supply chain, leaving us less susceptible to global crises and trends. Working people power our economy, and they should be at the heart of all our plans for the future. And they deserve solutions that work for them. Solutions that work as hard for them as they work for this country, not plans that try to put them out of a job. When it comes to inflation, there is so much to talk about and so many details to dive into. So that's why we have these experts behind me. And I want to introduce our expert panel and then let them get to it. So please join me in welcoming our moderator, Elise Gould, senior economist at the Economic Policy Institute, and our panelists, Bill Spriggs, the AFL-CIO's chief economist, and Rakeen Mahboud, chief economist and managing director of policy and research at Groundwork Collaborative, Mike Konzel, director of macroeconomic analysis at the Roosevelt Institute, and Josh Bivens, PhD, director of research at the Economic Policy Institute. So I just want to thank all of our panelists and for all of you to be here to really talk about what's happening to working people when it comes to inflation. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. You've made my job easier introducing all the panelists. I'm going to let them each speak for a couple of minutes, and then we're going to have some questions and have a discussion. So, Bill Spriggs, you're up.
Thank you. And thank you, President Shuler. I want to reemphasize two key points that President Shuler made. First, reporting on this out of context is not responsible. This is a global phenomena. And taking it to be provincial is dangerous. It diverts us from the current food crises that the world is facing. It prevents us from understanding the impact that Federal Reserve policy, raising interest rates has globally, and raising the difficulty for low-income countries to address the current immediate crises of the food shortage that the world faces. It makes us believe that we cannot respond to our own citizens when we characterize this as an American phenomenon driven by American demand. We cannot do as Germany and some other countries are doing, which is to address the needs of low-income households by increasing support for them addressing food and fuel cost. That austerity for Americans is dangerous. And to blame this crisis on the wages of American workers is equally irresponsible and dangerous. The wages of American workers have been shocked, as the entire system has, by the rising cost for all the reasons that President Shuler laid out. These shortages shocked the system, raised the level of prices, and real wages are falling. So a war like the Federal Reserve has declared on American wages, trying to keep American wages from rising, means you're making it more difficult for Americans to put food on the table. All Americans. There is this myth that attacking inflation is good for those who keep their jobs. It's not good for their wages. And currently their wages are falling. At some point, we have to have a conversation. When will wages catch up? When will wages close the gap between wages and productivity that have exploded over the last 40 years? When can America be on a path to greater equality? The simple arithmetic is at some point, we all have to agree that real wages get to rise. If we live in an environment where the Federal Reserve is going to attack wages all the time, we will never address that.
Thank you. Josh?
Yeah, I'm just going to raise a couple of things. First, as Bill said, as President Shuler said, thinking globally is really important here. For all the talk about how the allegedly too generous fiscal relief undertaken by the Biden administration led to overheating and is the root cause of today's inflation, you know, the surge in inflation has been global. It's been across countries that did very different policy responses. That just, to me, suggests a much more global root rather than any sort of specific policy effort that, you know, only happened in the U.S. And then I would just note that even if you did think that overheating was what led to this in the United States, it's really important to note how much contraction has already been done at the policy level. It's actually kind of shocking. And if you look at what has happened to domestic demand over the past year, that's demand, you strip out volatile inventories, you strip out net exports, just what American consumers are demanding, that's grown by just over 1% over the last full year. That is not the sign of an overheating economy. 1% growth in domestic demand is an economy that is already significantly cooling down. And if you look at fiscal policy has been more contractionary, and it's going to be more contractionary in 2022 than any year since the Korean War demobilization, and probably will beat even that. Basically, there's going to be an 8% decline in the budget deficit as a share of GDP. That is a bigger negative shock to demand than what happened in 2009 that led to the Great Recession. Now, we have underlying demand strength, so it's not going to lead exactly to that, but it is a scale of contraction that is already in the system that people really need to recognize before they ask the Federal Reserve to pile on even more contraction on top of that. And finally, I'll just say, you know, what we're really talking about today is how hard it's going to be to bring down any inflation that's already become entrenched in the system. Because like I said, the overheating has stopped. We are cooling this economy rapidly as we speak. The question is, will inflation become really entrenched? I mean, really simply, I just don't think the evidence is there that it's going to take a period of excess unemployment to bring down that entrenched inflation. I think you see a lot of sign of price pressure already responding to the sharp policy contraction that's already happened. And so now I just think there's a lot of price reductions and contraction in the pipeline that the Fed needs to appreciate and needs to be more patient about going forward.
Thank you, Rakeen. Thanks, Elise. And thanks to the AFL-CIO for hosting this really important conversation today. So I want to zoom out a little bit and make a couple of points. So first, today's inflation is rooted in really long-standing policy choices. Really long-standing power imbalances in our economy. Corporate power is really at the root of many of the price hikes that we've been seeing over the past year and change and that we're seeing today. Second, at the Groundwork Collaborative, we've been digging through earnings calls, and what we've seen is that corporate executives are not shy about how inflation and other recent crises have been very, very good for business. It's allowed them to jack up prices beyond what their input costs would justify. And this actually continues to be true even as supply chain pressures start to ease, as we're starting to see input costs grow. You know, in fact, just, you know, Q2 non-financial quarterly profits were the highest quarterly corporate profit margins in over 70 years. And then finally, given the deep costs of this cost of living crisis and the incredible pain it has wrought on families around the country, workers around the country, further aggressive rate hikes by the Federal Reserve would be ineffective, misguided, and bad for our economy. So I just wanted to drill down specifically on that last point because I think it's really important. So it is crystal clear that aggressive rate hikes by the Fed would do little to address the root causes of inflation, outsized corporate power, supply chain shortages, and the war in Ukraine. And as President Shuler alluded to, some economists like Larry Summers have suggested that unemployment rates need to go as high as 10% in order to bring down prices. That is frankly unconscionable. That would mean a 20% unemployment rate for Black workers. Workers, especially historically marginalized workers, cannot simply be collateral damage in the fight, in the effort to fight inflation. Asking workers to bear the brunt of a Fed-induced recession when they've also been the ones struggling to put food on the table because of higher prices is not just cruel and unfair, it's bad for our economy. Our economy is run by workers. Crushing the financial well-being of millions, especially Black and brown workers who have always left out of prosperity, would tank the economy. It's because when we do well, that's when our economy thrives. And, you know, importantly, these effects would not just be a one-time blip. There's a lot of research that shows that unemployment spells cause scarring effects, especially for Black and brown workers.
So understanding the root causes of today's inflation, particularly from the supply side, helps us better understand that there are a range of tools available to fight higher prices. There's a lot that federal policymakers and frankly folks in the states can do as well. The last thing I'll say before I turn it over to Mike is economists often talk about inflation and unemployment like they're just lines on a piece of paper to be manipulated without any care, right? But we should care because those lines, every single point along that line represents a family or a person who's trying to put food on the table and a roof over their heads. We can't ignore the devastating and very, very human costs of raising interest rates. So I'll pause there and turn it over back over to Lise.
Thank you. Mike?
Thank you. Thanks for having me. So when we look at where we're at right now, we talk about inflation as one number, one abstract thing. We use it year over year. We look at inflation over the past year, even though it's been a very chaotic year. When we look at inflation, where it is right now and what we can do to address it outside what the Federal Reserve is trying to do. Well, what stands out? One is global commodities in the wake of Russia's invasion of the Ukraine. And so that requires a policy response around energy, which the Biden administration has already started with a strategic reserve, with the Inflation Reduction Act. Europe is already turning to figuring out how to manage energy as an industrial policy, which is absolutely needed outside of demand policy. We look at goods. Goods are very elevated. I know it's almost cliche to mention now, but during the pandemic and during the recovery, people bought a lot fewer gym memberships and a lot more home gym equipment. The economy is still struggling to handle this major shift that just doesn't normally happen from services to goods, that is not fully normalized. We'd expect inflation and shortages in that process, but we'd also expect our businesses to be able to meet that demand and even bring down those prices. So there's a lot of ways from intervening in labor disputes to making sure that our supply chains are open and working and investing in them to help bring down that goods inflation, even push it into deflation. That would take another big chunk out of what we're experiencing. Next is services. Services are elevated, but a lot of that is housing. And there's a lot of ways we can intervene in the housing market without just crushing housing demand. First of all, as Josh has emphasized, we've already done a lot to raise mortgage rates. If you've been around the housing market, you see it's a lot cooler than it was even 3 months ago and especially 6 months ago. That's going to have a delay to when it shows up in the official metrics, but that will kick in eventually and sooner than we think. But there's also a housing bill that's in Congress. There's a lot of ways to intervene at the state and local level to boost housing supply and decrease housing insecurity. It would make a real dent in the way housing is playing out in our inflation numbers. And last, there's the question of corporate profits. Corporate markups are at their highest margins. Certainly last year, they're the highest margins they've been since we can have good records from the 1950s. A lot of people, even myself to an extent, thought that they would contract a bit this year and they haven't. They've probably expanded. Even outside of the energy industry, we just got a number that showed corporate profits are still at their highest margins. Those profits reflect real prices. And, either they can be shared within the firm more broadly with workers, which would take a huge amount out of pressure, or it would alternatively, with competition and with the government nudging of in ensuring competition, help bring down prices more broadly. So those four things really stand out to where we were before the pandemic. And those all aren't necessarily helped very much by demand destruction by the Federal Reserve and are especially helped by innovative and creative policy. And that's where I think we still need to be thinking about in order to address the real challenges inflation provide.
Thank you. President Shuler and our panelists have mentioned many different topics that I think we want to drill down on here, trying to make provide better context and take some of these abstract concepts and see what they really mean. So my first question is, let's start from the beginning. What are the sources of inflation? Where did it come from?
I'll give a first start. The biggest shock early on in 2021 was the dramatic collapse in domestic auto production, which took place because we couldn't get chips. All modern cars have computers that run them. This was a global phenomenon. Different countries had different rates of response because some of their companies did a better job of diversifying their chips, but this was a global phenomenon. And to put in context, we were producing cars at the level of the Great Recession, but that was caused because no one was buying cars. But we're producing cars at that way reduced level for over a year. Economists have never encountered a period in which something other than food or fuel had such a blockage. And that was the initial spark. Those shortages were clear in all other goods manufacturing because chips are in every modern appliance. And then we had the shock of the Ukraine war that Russia forced, and that meant a lack of fertilizer for our farmers. It meant a crisis in food supply. It meant a crisis in energy supply. And then global warming overtook us. Droughts in India, droughts in continued droughts in Africa, continued droughts in Italy, in France, and in China that dramatically reduced food production. These shocks to supply will not respond to any interest rate movement. You can make interest rates 1,000% if you want to, and it's not going to do anything to supply. You can, of course, kill demand, and you can say, oh, look, I got prices equal to what can be supplied, but then all of us will be out of work. And if you argue in the long run, that works out, as Keynes said, in the long run, we're dead. So these aren't good answers.
Yeah, just a couple of things. I think as important as anything is like where did this not come from? And so again, I think the standard story that we just made a big policy mistake and we did too generous fiscal relief and overheated the US economy. And to me, the most persuasive evidence against that is the international evidence. Like the big surge in inflation has been global, and it's just not true. Like a lot of people early on tried to say, well, the European inflation is totally different. It's all food and energy. It's not true at all. Core inflation in Europe actually looks a lot like core inflation in the United States does now. And yet they did very different things in terms of their fiscal response to COVID. And there's no mapping at all between countries that did more generous fiscal relief and having lower inflation. In fact, those two things do not correlate. And even further, some people said, okay, so it wasn't just a uniquely American mistake. Everyone made the mistake. There's just been global overheating across the advanced economies. If you correlate inflation and the change in unemployment over this crisis, you don't see the countries that have had the biggest declines in unemployment having the biggest increases in inflation. In fact, you actually see a little bit the opposite effect. It's more just a cloud and there's not much there. So it's just that the data signature of overheating just really isn't there. It really looks to me like something else. I think that's something else just in summary form, and people have said this, obviously shocks, economic shocks like we've never seen before. And I do think, you know, the part that has taken me, sort of the one thing I've gotten wrong trying to predict it, like the shocks were huge. The ripple effects were pretty big. I mean, basically when the shock comes, like when durable goods prices spike or when oil prices spike, there's sort of a scramble by economic actors to protect their own incomes. So workers start trying to get higher wages to protect themselves against the durable goods and the gas shocks. Normally, you know, given the past 40 years, I'd been like, they're going to try, but they're going to fail. Wage growth isn't going to budge at all. The labor market of 2020 was very weird. It gave workers some temporary sources of power they haven't had before. And so they're actually able to sort of push up their wages a bit, never faster than inflation. They were never able to fully protect themselves, but they were able to actually battle a little bit more than I would have thought. And then the supply chains just gave corporations, the supply chain blockages gave corporations just huge power to push back. But you just had that sort of distributional back and forth in response to the shocks that really propagated the inflation. That said, those ripple effects never threatened to sort of amplify the inflation. They always steadily dampen after the initial shock. The problem is the shocks keep coming. We had COVID in 2020. We had Omicron. We had the Ukraine war. At some point, the shocks will stop. The ripple effects will dampen and things will get better. And just one piece of evidence on this, you could argue, you know, the Ukraine and Omicron shock combined at the beginning of this year were arguably much larger economically than what came before. Yet wage growth has actually decelerated a bit since then. Like the 2021 labor market should not be the model of how workers are going to be able to protect themselves from these shocks going forward. We are reverting back for good and lots of bad to that sort of pre-COVID world where you're just not going to see those shocks propagate as much.
I'll just add a couple of things. I mean, I think Bill and Josh have really covered some really important points. And Bill brought up chips, right? I think it's important to note that the chips crisis is not just something that happened during the pandemic or happened during this particular period of time. It's decades and decades of deregulatory policy choices that allowed mega corporations to build this extremely brittle supply chain. And a big chunk of people who suffered from that are not just consumers who are paying higher prices now, but are workers, right? I mean, the just-in-time supply chain was made as, you know, with no fail safes, right? There's no backup. It's a system that has cut costs around every corner, and cutting costs means pushing down labor standards, pushing down wages. And it's a big reason why we are in a world where we're seeing you know, railway workers striking for unpaid or paid leave, right? I mean, this is, worker well-being is a critical part of our supply chain. And I think it's important to note, especially given where we are today. And to pick up a little bit on Josh's point, you know, these supply shortages have been very, very good for business. I mean, these executives on corporate earnings calls have not been shy about using those supply shortages to justify higher prices, even higher prices than what, you know, their input costs would justify. And then the last thing I'll say is, you know, it's not just us saying this. Chair Powell in June said that raising interest rates, quote, can't affect all the supply side things that are still pushing upwards, right? He knows that the tool he has in his hand is to crush demand. And if demand is not the thing that is driving higher prices, which it's not, then, you know, the interest rate hikes will be ineffective in bringing down prices.
And just one last point about building on what Josh said about wages, about where this is not coming from. And it's really important to note, this is one of the few times we've seen, certainly in my life, where there's been significant wage compression. People at the bottom of the income distribution are benefiting much more than people at the top of the income distribution. So when you hear about wages are causing inflation, the model of that is that there's just wages across the board are rising, but that's not actually what's happening. What's happening is that workers and services, workers who have been really brutalized over the last several decades in, you know, fissured workplaces, workplaces with very cruel working standards, those workers, through policy choices we made to have a strong recovery, to have a lot of jobs that need to be filled, to have generous unemployment insurance, those workers finally have a chance to bargain for better working conditions, and they are getting them. We are seeing wages at the bottom increase faster than they are at the top. And again, this is just, it's so unique, it's very hard to describe, but that's not inflation. That is not, if you hear an inflation number that's 8%, there's no credible evidence, and people are not really presenting it, that kind of dynamic, that which we want to see, is having anything to do with the inflation challenges we face. And it's important to not get those confused, because we have real challenges in inflation, and they are serious problems that require serious responses. But the labor market is something to celebrate right now. The wage growth that we're seeing, the wage compression we're seeing, and the low unemployment rate that still sees large job growth gains is not something we should be compromising.
Thank you. They're all great, great points. We seem unprepared for this. We don't seem to have a lot of policy tools in the toolkit. What went wrong in the 40 years beforehand that left us unprepared for this moment?
I think Rakeem raised the important vision for us to remember the disinflation fight that the Fed is trying to recreate, as if Paul Volcker was a saint, is the core to the problem. If you look at when did the Fed miss its target on inflation? It's missed it for the most part by having inflation below 2%. From a worker's perspective, that means you missed full employment. That means that because the Fed typically misses full employment and has raised the unemployment rate relative to what it was before 1980, you get what Rakeem pointed out, a dysfunctional labor market. You allow companies to make profit not by increasing productivity, but by lowering cost. These aren't exactly the same thing. And that pursuit of lower costs, specifically at the cost of workers, is at the heart of our problem. This is why we have these very fragile supply chains. This is why you have workers through the pandemic work to the bone, and you have the railroad workers rebelling that you have to accommodate our health. All of these bad working conditions are the result of having unemployment too high. It's a large permanent cost on wage gains. It's a de-incentivizes productivity gains, and it has a disproportionate burden on Black and brown workers who bear the biggest part of that cost. What we've seen in the last 2 years is the victory of workers to finally get towards $15 an hour in the majority of our states. We have 26 states that have raised the minimum wage. The wage gains that we have seen predominantly have come from a minimum wage returning to its historic relationship of half the median wage. If you look at workers who are young, if you look at workers who are in low-wage industries who are directly affected by this, you see they are the ones who have been getting the wage gains. If you look at manufacturing workers, if you look at older workers, you see they are not getting these wage gains. So this isn't being driven by a tight labor market. It's being driven by, for the first time since the 1960s, low-wage workers are benefiting from a policy that we have to raise wages together for everyone. And the wage compression that Mike pointed out is the direct result of, yes, and they're the only ones getting wage raises so far. If the response of the Fed is going to be, well, we can't pay Americans decent wages because that's inflationary, then we have a real problem as a nation. And that's the real critical key. And how do you present the story of what's causing this inflation? Because if it's going to be, we can't have decent wages for Americans, we can't have decent working conditions, if they form unions, that's inflationary. If that's the path we're going to be on, we're back to the 1980s, and we know, we watched the movie, we know that this is going to be continued stagnation for the American worker.
Yeah, I mean, I'll just say a couple words about the why we were so unprepared question. I mean, I think one angle of it is like we just were sort of intellectually unprepared for this. And it's we, like the two tribes I belong to, like macroeconomists who study the economy and progressive economic observers. I think we got a little lazy in our inflation analysis. In our defense, it was because we were, as Bill said, we were busy pointing out that we were spending literally decades making a massive macroeconomic policy error in exactly the other direction. Like we were consistently running the economy too soft. We were consistently missing the inflation target on the downside, not hitting full employment. I think this was a really valuable thing to spend our efforts in. And it's why, you know, it was true. And that's why we spent so much time doing it. But I think that's one reason why, like the idea that we would get a big shock that people would interpret as, you know, a genuine inflation that people would interpret as caused by overheating, the exact opposite problem. Yeah, I mean, I'm a little blindsided. And so I think in the next couple of years, we should be ready. And we've talked a lot up here about like other tools we should have in the toolkit to fight inflation. I think one reason we didn't stock the toolkit because inflation was just not a problem for 40 years. And so to just say one really quick example of these kind of tools, and like, it's not one I'm ready to completely sign off on because I have not done the work because we spent the past 20 years worried about the opposite problem. But like, you know, to the degree higher interest rates so far have done anything useful in fighting inflation, they have restrained home price growth over the past couple of years. I think that's good. Home prices were rising too fast. That's not good for anyone unless you're already a homeowner and your wealth is going up. Was there another way we could have restrained home price growth that wasn't just the across the board interest rate increase? Probably. There's regulatory tools. You could mandate a higher loan-to-value ratio when you banks offer mortgages or something like that. And so if there's like very specific, incredibly important prices in the economy, like home prices, like there, I think there's a question to ask going forward. Should we have more targeted tools that go after them rather than the across-the-board kind of blunderbuss of interest rate increases? But we don't have those tools because we didn't think about them because, you know, we're facing the exact opposite problem for decades. I hope this is just a one-off. Like, I really do think lots of today's inflation 3 years from now is just going to be like, yeah, that was that crazy time when there was a global pandemic and war, and you know, but probably shouldn't bank on it. We probably actually should spend some intellectual time trying to figure out what to do if anything similar to this happens again.
Yeah, I mean, I think again, as usual, my co-panelists have covered really important points. I guess I will just zoom out and say that, you know, the inflation that we're experiencing now is not like the weather. It doesn't just happen because, right? The inflation that we're experiencing now is because of a series of policy choices that we've made that has handed power over to big corporations to design a system that works really well for them and works really poorly for pretty much everyone else. You know, they struck a deal really with the American consumer. We'll get you cheap goods and we'll crush everything else and make ourselves massive profits. As soon as a shock hit the system, that system broke down, right? And again, I just, given where we are, I think it's important to call out the effects that that has had on workers, right? I think truck drivers are a really good example. Until the 1980s, truckers, especially folks who are on long-haul journeys, were considered employees by companies whose routes and rates were regulated. Drivers were largely unionized. They could expect good pay, good benefits, a good life, basically. But in 1980, the Motor Carrier Act really drove a race to the bottom in labor standards. It deregulated the industry. It drove down trucker wages, working conditions, and unionization rates. So come to today, all these companies, XPO, other logistics companies are saying, oh, we have a trucker shortage. Like, do we have a trucker shortage or do we have a shortage of really good trucker jobs, right? These are policy choices. These are the result of decisions that we have made as policymakers and policy experts, and we can make different policy choices. And just to put one more point to really kind of land the plane on something that Mike and Bill were saying, low wage workers' wages going up is a good thing for our economy. Our economy runs on our demand, our productivity, our labor, right? So when workers are doing well, that's when the economy does well. And I think it's just really important to name that. Workers should not be collateral damage in the fight against higher prices.
Yeah, and two quick points. As everyone has said, we spent the last decade arguing, last several decades, in fact, arguing that the economy was running too cool. Unemployment was always too high. Inflation was always a little too low. And in the Great Recession, we particularly saw this where, our economy went into a downturn and never really recovered back to trend. Just kind of stayed in this perpetually depressed economy compared to the economy we could have had with better policy. And people are debating the specifics of the specific number in this moment, but we basically returned to trend. We've returned right back to where we would have been. Otherwise, we may even be in a stronger position, ironically, in terms of the amount of income we can produce, which is totally wild. And there's two ironies of this. One is that it is interesting to note how many economists, even economists who are critical of, say, the American Rescue Plan, believe that once we're past the next few years and inflation is resolved one way or the other, we're going to be back in that old world of so-called secular stagnation. That none of the fundamental things that have really driven that kind of pressure that pushes the economy down, whether you think it's inequality, corporate concentration, demographics, global need for safe assets and other kinds of financial instruments, none of that's fundamentally changed. And so if we don't come out of this in a stronger economy, if we don't come out of this with better tools and better ideas and better practices for managing the economy, we're going to be right back in that old stage. We're not going to end up in like some sort of weird Goldilocks in the middle. Like there's we need to be able to figure out how to solve this problem of the business cycle and inflation in order to not just end up back where we were. And second, ironically, a lot of the people at the time during the Great Recession often argued for a higher inflation target. Basically, they said that having inflation at 2% is a little dangerous because it puts us in this trap where you either are perpetually depressed or you overshoot. And inflation needs to come down. People are not happy about it. It's really harming people. Do we need to get it to 2%? Well, that's a really arbitrary number. If you actually look at the history, it's basically picked out of a hat. There's a lot of peer countries, Canada, Australia, who have better macroeconomic conditions than we do, that use bands, that use higher targets. There's a wide variety of things we could do. So as inflation comes down, there's going to be people who say, well, we need to get unemployment really high to get it to that 2% number. And I don't know why we would want that. If inflation was 3%, 3.5%, and the labor market was as dynamic as we see right now, that would be a good thing to change. And that's something that I think we need to talk about more as the economy evolves.
That's great. I think it's been well established that inflation is not coming from the labor market, but raising rates can hurt the labor market. What are we seeing signs of that now, or what do you expect to see in the future?
So we're already seeing the signs of the damage for Black workers and beginning to see it for Hispanic workers. Despite the news of all of these job openings that are posted, we all realize those numbers aren't realistic and have no meaning. You can look at actual workers to see, are those postings meaningful? And as those postings decline, they're going to be correlated with the decline in real job openings. Black workers are the most sensitive to, are you actually hiring? We've seen those postings drop for 3 months. We've seen Black labor force participation, which soared in 2021 in response to those postings and hiring. We see Black labor force participation shrink and Black unemployment go up. So Black unemployment last month went up for all the wrong reasons, despite everybody looking at the top headline numbers. The share of Black workers in the labor force was down. The share of Black workers working a job was down. The share of Black workers who was unemployed went up. This has been going on for the last 2 months in terms of the increase, the decrease in labor force participation for 3 months. This is a clear sign this is a slowing. Everybody said, oh, well, you know, the unemployment rate went up for the good reasons. No, it went up for the wrong reasons if these job openings really had any meaning. Because when labor force participation increased as it did in August, because white workers finally started coming back, then most of them should have been hired. If there are all these job openings per worker and more people enter, then they should have been hired in big numbers. They weren't. So labor force participation was up. The share of people holding a job was up, but the share of people unemployed also was up. So that's a clear sign that these job openings aren't meaningful job openings. Otherwise, the unemployment rate would have fallen in August. It's a clear sign we have reached an arena in which the labor market is not functioning in a tight way. Black unemployment, once it starts going up, does not just come down because somebody snaps their fingers or somebody over at the Federal Reserve down the street there prays that somehow or another they haven't blown the economy for everybody. And for them to do it with a crocodile tear that, well, inflation hurts workers more because a bigger share of their income goes to food. Well, yeah, but if I have no job, I don't care what you're charging for food because it's irrelevant. So this idea that you're doing this for my, you're making me lose my job for my benefit is the height of mean condescension to say that to someone. I want to stop because I'll start cussing.
Yeah, I mean, I'll just say a couple quick things. I would say in terms of what have rates done to the rate hikes done to the labor market so far, there are the sort of signs of weakness that the bill is talking about. I think the hope is like they're temporary and maybe we haven't damaged it yet. But like I said, we've got a lot of contraction that's already come into the system that could really drop on us. And let me just say two things about like where it's really kind of predictable, where there's going to be a big drop off in activity over the next 6 to 12 months. I mean, one is housing. There were a ton of housing starts before, say, June 2022 in the previous year. Lots of those are still going on that you don't stop halfway, even if home prices are starting to fall, because then you just lose everything. But once the completions happen, housing starts have just plummeted. And so we've got a lot of people who are on jobs now finishing houses that there will not be another job for them on the other end of that. And so I think we're going to see some very large lagged declines in sort of home building activity unless something changes. And then the other one, we've talked a lot about how the big surge in durable goods demand during COVID, you know, people quit their gyms, bought Pelotons, decided to redo their house, bought a couch. There's already going to be some bounce back to that. Like no one buys a new couch every year. And so the fact that we did so much durable goods buying in those years, it was already going to be a little bad. But then the dollar is through the roof. And a really strong dollar sounds great. It means your exports are really uncompetitive on world markets. And so that's going to be a double blow to durable goods. And that tends to come with a lag as well. And so you can look at last month's jobs report, and there are many reasons to think that overall, in the aggregate, that was a really strong jobs report. And I think it was, but I think, you know, Fed policy is all about being forward-looking. What's coming down the pike at us? And what's coming down the pike at us is just a lot of predictable contraction. And so I think just larding up sort of more rate increases going forward on top of that is going to be really damaging.
Yeah, totally agree. I mean, rate increases would harm exactly the people who have been most harmed by rising prices in the first place, right? And in some cases, doubly so, because workers who are at corporations who have been sort of crushed by this downward drive in job quality and downward pressure on wages are also the same consumers who have paid exorbitant amounts of money for basics like diapers and laundry detergent, right? So I'll just leave it there. I mean, I think this is going to put pain on exactly the same people who are feeling the most pain right now.
Yeah, I think that covers it all.
Great. So we just saw the latest inflation numbers. If the Fed shouldn't raise interest rates, then what is the solution? What does disinflationary policy really look like?
I think, as Josh mentioned, intellectually, the Fed was caught wrong-footed. It has not helped. It is America's economic professor. It should be explaining the economy better to the American people. Going forward, we will face years like this again because of the effects of global warming. The drought in China is not only creating more consternation for our food crises, but they rely heavily on hydroelectric power from the Yangtze River. So going forward, there's going to be power crises. Our own Colorado River, which is responsible for huge amounts of hydroelectric power in the western part of the United States. These are crises we're going to have. The idea that we're going to have more tornadoes, but there's some mystical guard over key factories, that they can't be hit by tornadoes, because the tornadoes can only hit trailer parks. I mean, that's not science. And we've repeatedly found that one or two factories are a major supplier of some good. Going forward, the Fed needs to remodel. How do we measure price movements? How do we get people to understand that these shocks are going to become more common? They will be severe shocks. How do we talk about other measures of inflation and get reporters to comment on the other measures of inflation that are out there, where you trim away the excess movements, where you talk about when the movements are very high, which is the other thing that shocked us, because these shocks were so big, we failed to incorporate the ripple effects. Like, if you're not making new cars, and at the level we weren't making cars, there's going to be a big effect on used car prices because we aren't making cars. And the Fed's flat-footedness and not observing that we weren't making cars is totally irresponsible. And for them to not notice that, well, yes, the auto workers are still on the job, they're finishing the cars, and they're being told by the president of General Motors, we're hauling the cars and we're just warehousing them until we can get the chips, for them to not be cognizant of that and the huge impact that would make, that's just irresponsible. They have a building filled with economists who aren't doing their job. So going forward, we're going to have to do better at understanding that these shocks will occur, and therefore we need something for these supply shocks. And we need to have a mechanism to prevent profiteering, which we know is the big problem. Markina and her group have driven this home for us. If there was a hurricane, the first thing we would do is cut off those companies that want to charge $90 for a bottle of water. We all understand that. But we're in a similar situation, but we're not stopping that same sort of profiteering. So we need to have a different view going forward, because global warming is here. It's not going to go away. It's only going to become more severe. And we need better intellectual power brought to how do you handle these kind of shocks that are going to be massive coming forward.
Yeah, in terms of, like, if not raising rates, then what from the Fed's perspective? I mean, my big thing for them is, like, mostly wait and see what the huge policy contraction we've already done actually yields us. Like, we have some time to wait. Like, if inflation was still accelerating right now, and there was a lot of evidence that, like, the overheating of the economy was somehow getting worse, if domestic demand growth was accelerating, then there'd be a real case for restraining demand growth. But demand growth is falling rapidly. Lots of measures of price pressure going forward look set to come down. We've got some time to sort of wait and see and protect the good parts of the labor market that we have today without responding too much. You know, as Bill said, and as everyone has said, these were huge, real shocks to the physical economy. They were going to hurt. There is no one neat trick that the Fed has to somehow save the unemployment rate we have, which they should try to save, and somehow just turn the dial back on inflation. That's not how it works. These were genuinely huge shocks to the economy. And I do think Bill's point about these are shocks that are kind of a dress rehearsal for some things that might happen going forward is really key. We should think a lot about, I mean, this is tired stuff, but it's true. We should think a lot about energy policy. Like, and even in the very short run, the International Energy Agency has a list of 10 things economies can do right now to reduce oil demand very quickly. We should do them. We're really not doing them in any real way. Stuff from, you know, encourage work from home, make public transit a lot cheaper, maybe even do, you know, command and control stuff like alternate days of driving that you allow. Like, if this is a real emergency, if it is so important to get inflation down, we're willing to throw millions of people out of work, why aren't we willing to do things like that? And then finally, I'll just say, following Europe's lead, you know, we should really think about fiscal transfers to the worst off to protect them from the price increases, financed by progressive taxes. And maybe one of those progressive taxes could be an excess profits tax, as I think Mike said. And I really was a little optimistic that falling profit margins were going to provide some relief this year, like 2021, largest profit spikes in history. Hasn't happened yet. I mean, I think there's still time for something like an excess profits tax to be a useful part of the inflationary toolkit.
Yeah, we are often very quick to go to the Fed as a solution to price hikes. The Fed is not the only policy actor that can actually make change here, right? There's a lot that policymakers across the federal government and across states can do to bring down prices. I mean, we've gotten to some of these things today, right? Policymakers could encourage competition in key product markets. We could curtail mergers along key nodes of the supply chain. I mean, the Ocean Shipping Reform Act starts to get at that, which is really exciting. 34 states have a price gouging statute. Let's empower state AGs to enforce that, right? Let's put in place a federal price gouging statute. Let's empower the FTC to go after pandemic profiteers. We can invest more in our infrastructure, right? That's something that that's long overdue. Again, we've already started, but there's always room for more. And we can also invest in sectors that have been eating into family budgets for decades, like childcare and healthcare. To Josh's point, we should increase taxes on corporations who are making bank off of these crises, right? Bank off of out of our pockets, really. And we should make sure that workers have the protections that they need and deserve in their workplaces to be able to to interact in the economy and participate in the economy in the way that they would like to. That is not a comprehensive list, but there are many, many, many tools available to us to bring down prices. We should not necessarily constrain ourselves to the Fed. I think this panel has thoroughly covered why doing so would be a massive mistake.
These are all great points. Yeah, I just want to emphasize the corporate profits point again. It'd be one thing if these profits were, spurring new products or new investments, but they're largely just going to bosses and shareholders and various pay packages or buybacks. So, if it was productive, that might be something to consider, but it's not. It's just sitting there. It's just going to people who already have so much. So an excess profits tax makes a lot of sense in this context. There's a lot of things you could do with that. Reemphasize housing. You know, there is a housing bill in Congress. I don't know if it's likely to see much momentum, but it is something that could be done that could have some impact pretty quickly. Third, I think there's also, and we saw it in reverse in the Great Recession, so a little bit of like chasing the monthly number and missing the underlying trend. So like this number was high in the sense that it was higher than what people had guessed, but that guess is a real frame, like it's just guesswork. The number is higher than we want it to be, but it's in line with where it was over the last several months. And we know over the last several months, a lot of contractionary actions were taken on the fiscal and monetary side. And so, chasing the month-to-month number can kind of distract us from what a more underlying trend is. And while that trend is still very high, there's a lot of counterwinds to it that are going to slow it in the next couple of months. And, just as the previous month was very low, this one was higher than expected. The underlying trend is towards a contractionary policy that's already going to take a lot of heat or a lot of energy out of the economy. And we want to make sure we do not overdo that, because Goldman Sachs thought it was going to be 0.3 and it was 0.6, or something like that, which is fundamentally not what the economy is about. As Rakeen and others have pointed out, it's about work, it's about people and living the lives that they want to lead.
I just want to get back to your answer on disinflation. But we have to remember the Fed can raise unemployment, but it can't lower it. And so once the unemployment rate goes up, it takes years, not months, years for it to come back down. So we're telling American workers, your real wages have fallen. We're going to push them down further, and it's going to take 8 years for you to get your jobs back, so that we can now have a discussion once again about getting your real wages back up. This is the kind of thinking of perpetually lowering the wages of American workers that put us in this position. We don't want 8 years of low real wages. We don't want 8 years of high unemployment. The Fed doesn't get to turn things back on. They only have a brake pedal. They don't have an accelerator pedal.
So as we wrap up this session, I think it's been fantastic, great information. I want to think about whether or not we can still have nice things. Does inflation mean we have to trim our ambitions in other areas of policy? And how can we better convey there what is going on? Maybe let's start the other end, if you don't mind.
Sure. So one thing that jumps out at me is that, for the last 10 years, pre-pandemic, there's a big debate among labor economists over whether or not you could ever get Americans to switch jobs again. It was like considered a mini crisis. Like people aren't moving to take jobs, they're not quitting. There's low so-called labor market dynamism. We knew it was much higher in the 90s. It's dropped off over the last 20 years. And the last year and a half has been a massive boost to labor market dynamism. People are, as EPI calls it, a great upgrade. People are switching jobs. They're finding more productive jobs. They're getting paid more. Job switching is so key to people building wages and skills and their career ladders. And here's the dirty secret about all this. The unemployment rate cannot explain inflation. And so the people who say we need 10% unemployment to bring down inflation, if those numbers were true, the model that was true, that was used to generate it, to get the inflation we saw, we would need unemployment to have to go to negative 1%, 0%. It's obviously 3.5 to 4%. And so in order to do that, but since that didn't click in the model, they've all like run around to find something new. And they're like, well, job openings, that's clearly the problem. The fact that businesses want to hire people and people aren't getting hired as fast. That's the problem. When, that was one of the most central problems of the last decade. So, we can talk about this and we're going to be talking about this more in the months ahead. But, as Josh said, we're already seeing quits come down. We're already seeing, certain parts of the household survey slow down quite dramatically. We can still have a dynamic labor market. It's what we wanted. And it's incredibly important for people's careers, people's trajectories, the economy as a whole. And not use this as a weird excuse to try to argue wages and workers are causing inflation when that doesn't really pan out in the data.
The short answer to your question, Elise, is no. We should absolutely not trim our ambitions. I mean, I think it's just really important to name the pre-pandemic economy is not our goal. It's not our endpoint, right? The pre-pandemic economy was broken for millions and millions of people for decades. So, and in this moment, especially as we're continue to go through, a sort of unprecedented moment when, the cracks are showing, right? We've seen our reliance on precarious labor and what that has gotten us. We've seen our reliance on, how much help and support and incredible boost public investment can do for workers, for families throughout a crisis. So let's not sell ourselves short. Let's not curtail our ambitions because someone is telling us we have to in order to bring down prices. As we just went through these policy responses, there's a lot that we can do, not just to bring down prices, but actually to boost the lives of people around this country and to strengthen our economy as a whole. And that is really the direction we should be heading, certainly not pulling ourselves back.
Yeah, I'll just say a couple quick things. And so totally agree. I would say, to take a really classic example of, debates about whether or not the federal government should do something ambitious on childcare. Like people's need for childcare doesn't change all that much if the unemployment rate's 8% or 4%. It's just sort of a steady need that families have. And if we think it's a good thing to do, and I think it's a really good thing to do, that doesn't change just because the business cycle changes. And inflation is, if you think inflation is just being driven by overheating, that's just a business cycle problem. So, they're not problems that match up. I would say in fiscal policy, it might change how you think things should be financed. Like, during when we were just at really excess levels of unemployment in the 2010s, a lot of things that were useful to do, you could say, they're useful to do and we don't even need to pay for them. If we deficit finance them, that just means we get the useful thing like childcare and we get net new jobs. Now, if we really are sort of more labor constrained, I think It'd be easy to overstate how labor constrained we are, but if we are, that just means you should pay for it. So you should make the childcare investments and you should find some progressive tax to pay for it. That's fine with me. I like progressive taxes even just for themselves. And then in the sort of labor stance, so in fiscal policy, I think it's just a really bad faith, you know, effort to stop needed investments. Maybe it changes how you finance it, but that's it. On the labor standards space, you see people saying, you know, we can't raise the minimum wage because that would just, you know, add some boost to inflation. You know, when you run the numbers on that, even the most ambitious minimum wages could not be more trivial. Even if you assume every single extra dollar of the wage bill just gets passed directly on to customers, it doesn't lead to more productivity. It doesn't lead to lower profit margin. Even if every last cent got passed on directly to customers, it's still a trivial amount of money because, you know, I think this is something Mike alluded to before. The low wage workforce just accounts for a very small share of total labor costs in the United States. Where most of the labor costs sit are basically in corporate suites and really highly paid professional managers. And so, you know, in efforts to boost labor standards, I just, again, there's a good faith debate to be had about inflation and what the Fed should do. And then there's a ton of bad faith debates about how inflation, that nice thing you want to do, we just cannot do. I think those bad faith debates should really be called out for what they are.
And that's what I worry about the most, because the lingering undertone of the bad faith part of this debate is that the rapid recovery that we got from what took place in 2020 was a bad thing. So yes, earlier this week, we got the poverty numbers and we found out we can actually have a recession and child poverty can go down. We found out that household income doesn't have to suffer. We found out that our government actually can help us, and the sun is still up and the earth didn't end. This is an attempt to say those were bad policies, that we must suffer. And I don't understand why we want to accept the bad faith narrative coming out of this debate. The hypocrisy. Normally it's workers who are told, well, you have to deal with, you know, Schumpeterian economics and we'll have free trade and yes, you'll lose your job and you'll just switch to something. And we're told, oh, you just don't get it. And in the last 2 years, we saw workers shift from low-wage industries to high-wage industries. This was prominent for all workers. Black workers specifically overachieved in getting out of low-wage industries into manufacturing, into transportation, even breaking into construction. Women moving into construction, manufacturing, transportation. That's creative destruction to the benefit of workers. But now we're told, no, we don't want creative destruction. We want what we used to have. We want workers in low wages and low wage industries and getting paid low wages. This is a moment of high hypocrisy and a lot of bad faith. And I've been disturbed that reporters haven't seen through the essence of a lot of what is being said. We should be celebrating the labor market right now, that instead of 8 years, in 2 years, we regained every payroll position. We should be celebrating that it's at higher wages. We should be celebrating that we know our economy can work for people. And to turn it on its head at this moment is disturbing. And hopefully the lesson coming forward will not be people are told, well, you can't do that because that'll just spark inflation and you'll hurt the people that you were trying to help. Let's hope that that's not the lesson coming from this.
Well, I'm going to wrap up this panel. Thank you so much to President Shuler, to the AFL-CIO, and all of our panelists, and bringing to light so many very important points.